I'm Kurt Keutzer, professor of ECS at UC Berkeley, and today I'm going to be talking about creating a high-level architecture. So here's a quick look at our pattern language. We go from an application through structural and computational patterns, and today I'm going to be focused on this highest level of the pattern language. When we architect parallel software, we look at 10 structural patterns and 13 computational patterns, and we hierarchically refine one in terms of the other. We're going to focus today on just three structural patterns, but first let's talk about what are the elements of a structural pattern. So it's very simple. There are just components, which is where the computation happens, and they're connectors, where the communication happens. This is a slight variation on Garwin and Shaw, said connectors are where the interaction happens. Here we see the interaction happening by way of explicit communication. This is the set, our inventory of structural patterns, and we claim, I stand here today and claim, that we can build arbitrary complex software structures out of simply these 10 software patterns. Today I'm going to focus on pipe and filter, iterator, and map and reduce. So first, pipe and filter. So in a pipe and filter structural pattern, we have a set of pipes embodying the communication and filters embodying the computation. Each filter only sees inputs and produces outputs, and there's no global or shared state. So what are some examples of that? Well, almost every large software program has pipe and filter structure at the top level. Other examples are compilers. We'll see an image retrieval system later. And one that I worked with for many years, a logic optimizer, had at its top level a pipe and filter structure. The second structural pattern we consider is the iterator pattern. This is another very simple pattern. We have an initialization condition. We go into a large body where a variety of functions can be formed asynchronously. At the end of that body, the results are synchronized. Then we typically ask an exit condition. Is that exit condition met? If so, then we simply continue. If not, then we iterate again. Some examples of this. Here's a training a classifier and support vector machine training. So imagine we're kind of building a fence in n-dimensional space. In one iteration, we update the surface and we identify all the outliers, basically feature vectors that are on the wrong side of the fence. If they're within an acceptable error range, then we continue. Otherwise, we iterate again and update the surface. The third structural pattern we consider is MapReduce. Now, I understand that Google has, to a certain extent, redefined MapReduce in cluster scale computing, but we're going to harken back to the early days of lists. And for us, MapReduce means a map stage where computations are mapped onto sets of independent data, and a reduce stage where the results of the map stage are summarized, i.e. reduced. What are examples of this? Well, again, with our generalized notion of this, we see this apply to many data parallel applications. And so, for example, in that same support vector machine computation I was talking about, that computation associated with identifying the outliers, that is itself mapped on, and then the greatest outliers are then the result of the reduction. So quick summary on structural patterns. So identifying the structural pattern for a portion of an application is the key to creating program modularity. And creating program modularity is in turn the key to improving correctness, manageability, and maintainability. Personally, I'd say structural patterns help me to feel organized. I show you just three structural patterns, but we have been able to build significant applications in machine learning and multimedia analysis with just these three. Next, let's consider computational patterns. So here again is our inventory of computations. Today we're going to be talking about structured grid and two varieties of matrix operation, dense matrix and sparse matrix. So when I first tried to present overviews of computational patterns, I got really nervous. How can you possibly talk about all linear algebra in just a few slides? And then I realized it's actually quite easy. Linear algebra fundamentally operates on three data types: scalars, vectors, and matrices. Here's a scalar, here's a vector, here's a matrix. It has a few basic operations: vector-vector multiply, matrix-vector multiply, and matrix-matrix multiply. What are some examples of this? Well, we can do a simple linear map, we can more generally solve linear equations, or we can compute eigenvalues or eigenvectors. In general, these are kind of canonized in a set of basic linear algebra subroutines. These three levels, known as BLAS, are characterized by their intrinsic ratio of computation to memory movement. In BLAS 1, we have simple vector-vector operations. In BLAS 2, we have matrix-vector. In BLAS 3, matrix-matrix, with the most intense computation to memory movement. Now, an important thing is, as simple as it may seem to identify that one is doing a matrix-matrix or matrix-vector operation, the key thing is that this allows us to capitalize on a broad range of resources of linear algebra, some of which are depicted here. Next, let's look at the computation of structured grid. So structured grid, first we imagine our data is arranged in a multidimensional grid, and computation is composed in one or more steps. In one step, every vertex on the grid, and here we're highlighting the red vertex, is updated by a small number of neighborhood vertices around that vertex, here in blue. What are some examples of this? Well, here's a popular one, convolution. So on the left side here, we see we're computing one pixel in the context of several neighboring pixels. On the right side, we're seeing we're being more economical in data movement by computing four pixels in a larger neighborhood. We can use this for doing something like edge detection on an image. Applying this simple filter, we're able to identify horizontal edges in an image. Other applications include heat diffusion, where the temperature of a vertex will be influenced by the temperature of its neighbors, or fluid dynamics, where the movement of a single particle will be influenced by its neighboring particles. Now again, our support when we identify something as a structured grid computation is not nearly as strong as in the case of linear algebra. However, we do have a CACTUS programming framework which is focused on the structured grid model. So here's a quick summary on the computational patterns. Identifying the computational patterns for a portion application is the key to identifying the right library or framework, identifying the right parallel algorithm. But again, maybe more important to me is the personal perspective is, computational patterns make me feel smart. Why is that? Well, Alan Kay said the right perspective is worth 100 IQ points. What computational patterns do for me is they give me an invaluable perspective on the world of applications. Computational patterns have enabled my research group to publish on machine learning, speech recognition, computer vision, medical image processing, computational finance, as well as other areas. We could have never done this if we got into the details of these application areas without the organizing principle of the computational patterns. So, briefly, structural patterns help me feel organized, computational patterns help me feel smart. So as an example, we're going to look at classification using support vector machines. So Mrs. Catanzaro has a problem. She has hundreds of gigabytes of photos. Most of them are of her children, some are of flowers. She'd like to be able to find her children without sorting through all the flower photos. Sounds like a job for a support vector machine classifier. In a support vector machine classifier, what we do is we take examples of children, extract their features and train a classifier, and examples of flowers, extract the features and train the classifier. In some sense, we reduce each photo to a vector in N space, and then we build a fence in N space which separates on one side our children, on the other side our flowers. So let's go through the architecture of this. At the top level, looking at this example, what's the structural pattern? It's kind of obvious to see it's pipe and filter. As a matter of fact, as we mentioned earlier, almost all sophisticated software programs are at the top level, pipe and filter. So now let's go through each of the individual filters in this pipe and filter design, starting with feature extraction. So on the left-hand side, we've expanded feature extraction down to build scale space representation, selecting interest points, and building descriptors. What's the structural pattern of this? Again, it's pipe and filter. Now looking at each of the individual filters, we see for the build scale space representation, that's a computation structured grid. For selecting interest points and support regions, we actually have another structural pattern, MapReduce, and each of those functions being mapped as dense linear algebra. And then finally, for building the descriptors, we have a MapReduce again for a structural pattern inside that filter, and then the computation inside of the maps are their structured grid. Looking next at train classifier, what's the structural pattern of this? Well, it's two really. At the outer loop, we can see its iterative refinement. Inside, we can see a simple pipe and filter structure with the updating optimality conditions and selecting the working set and solving the quadratic program. Looking inside each of the filters of the pipe and filter, we see a MapReduce and dense linear algebra for each. Now let's look at the actual exercising of the classifier. So what's the structural pattern for this? It's again pipe and filter. Looking inside each of the filters of the pipe and filter, we see first we have computing the dot products using dense linear algebra, and the second, computing the kernel values, summing and scaling. This is essentially when we're exercising the classifier, we're taking a vector in N space and we're seeing on which side of the fence did it land. Here, to see which side of the fence it landed, we're looking at MapReduce with a mapping a densener algebra formula. So altogether, this puts together a real support vector machine mini framework. So this is not a toy example, as simple as it may seem. The support vector machine framework was able, when results compared to LibSVM, the standard support vector machine tool, to achieve a 9 to 35x speedup for training, 81 to 138 for classification, and we've had over 3,000 downloads of the software since its release a few years ago, and over 200 citations since its publication. So in summary, we believe the key to productive and efficient parallel programming is creating a good software architecture, which is a hierarchical composition of structural patterns which enforce modularity. And I showed you just three of these, but seven more will be all you need. Computational patterns which provide efficiency and help us to identify key computations to be parallelized. Again, I showed you three, and 10 more of those will be all you need. And following this approach, we have felt smart and organized, and thus have been able to get impressive performance results on many applications. I showed you just one, there are many more. If you'd like to see more about the patterns, we have a web address, and then publications I've described here can be found at this web address.
Hey, I hope you liked this video. If you haven't seen our other videos on the Intel Software YouTube channel, remember to subscribe, and don't forget to leave us a comment and tell us what other material you might like to see and chat with other enthusiasts who watch our shows.